Have you heard of this video game called Untitled Goose Game, Heather?
Is that Fortnite's cousin?
No. So you haven't heard of this at all? Like not seen
No,
memes
I
of it?
haven't.
Okay.
No, and
Oh.
I memes and I game, so I don't know.
Wow, okay. So I'm about to blow your mind. Okay, so this is a computer game and I think it's also on like Nintendo Switch. It's basically a goose simulator where you play a goose. And you're just going around this little town and you're just being a dick to everybody.
So it's like Goat Simulator.
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, nice. But you're a goose.
But you're a goose. And like there's tasks you can do. You don't have to do them. It just kind of proceeds. You just move on to like the next stage, if you will, if you do these things. But it's like a sandbox. You can just kind of walk around and grab things from people and like steal things and hide them.
This
And
is like geese in real life.
pretty much so, yeah.
It is.
That's
It's
what
on
they
the
were that's what
beaches.
they were going
Yes.
for. You gotta check this out.
Oh
You
my
gotta
gosh.
look up the memes. There's all these memes about it. There's these playthroughs on YouTube. And it's like $20 if you download it from like the developer onto your PC, which is what I did. And I've been playing it like nonstop since Friday. I got it Friday evening and I've been playing nothing but this. 'Cause it's just so it's so calming but so infuriating because the things you're trying to do, like one of the things you gotta do is I guess steal like things from people and it says like steal this guy's keys, and so you steal the guy's keys but then they come chasing after you, in like the superhuman speed, like suddenly they're moving like la di da di da. Then you steal something from them, and they're like fucking like the Flash or something, chasing after you, and then they grab you, and it's like, dude, I'm running as fast as I can. I'm a fucking goose. I can't run fast, all right? I got web feet. I got a goose-shaped body, and I'm just trying to get over to this pond so you can leave me alone. But no, you had to come immediately, step up to me, and find me.
Let
And
me
it,
ask you this.
yeah.
Can you poop everywhere? Is there pooping?
No,
Please
there
tell
is
me that they
not.
at least poop.
There's no pooping,
That's
unfortunately.
all they do.
I know
That's all they do.
that's like I guess the one thing I guess they didn't want to go that far in the realism.
Fair enough.
Yeah. I mean, maybe they'll come up with an expansion pack and you can like buy like the poop expansion for $5.
Yeah, and different kinds of poop. Like you could have rainbow poop, you could have exploding poop. I mean, there is endless possibilities of the poop, and it could be fun. I mean, I would be interested in that.
And much like real geese, they have the ability. This goose has the ability to fly, but he doesn't. It just walks around everywhere. And so, and like,
If you can fly?
yeah. And so, you're just in these four different stages. Like, one of them's a garden, and you have to like mess with this gardener. You gotta lock him out of his garden and like pull up his like carrots and cabbage and stuff. Then you go to this like storefront. Where this lady has like a sidewalk sale, you're just messing with her stuff. And there's a little, oh, the funniest fucking thing, and I'm not even kidding you. There's this little boy outside of the shop, and he's playing with like a toy airplane or whatever. But if you honk at him, and yes, you can honk in this game like a goose. It is very therapeutic, let me tell you. But if you honk at him, the boy gets scared and runs away. And it's very thrilling to chase after this little boy while honking at him and he's running from you. Like the fucking demon is like on his heels.
That's what they're like, though. That's what they do in real life. This is real. This is reality.
Yeah.
I see grown men run like I run. I and they just are everywhere. And you see grown men running to the road where there are giant cars because there are geese on the path.
Yes, no, I
They
know.
are evil.
Yeah, like
I'm
my apartment complex, there's two ponds and they like chill here all the time and they're like walking around like on the streets in the apartments and so they're just like constantly in the way and like you said they're pooping everywhere and they make these loud noises in the springtime 'cause they're having sex and
Yes.
it's crazy. Now there's no sex to this. Maybe that's the third expansion maybe for that. That'll be
That would
to
be good.
mate with another goose.
The odd honking coming. Yeah.
So Heather, I know you're into video games. You should probably check this out. I think you'd get a kick out of it. The same for anyone out there listening. Like it's called the Untitled Goose Game. I don't know why they called it that. I remember reading like a thing from the developer that they were surprised this became as popular as it was, because he says, "This is just a goose simulator. I don't get what the big deal is." But it's like fucking hilarious.
That's exactly why.
It's hilarious.
Liam, he has the Switch. We all have our own consoles in this house. We're all big gamers, but none of us are huge PC players. We do have our PCs.
Okay, it is on the Switch. But, you can get on the Switch. Yeah, you should totally look for it.
But he probably already knows about it, so when I ask him about it tomorrow, he's going to look at me like I'm either really cool or really stupid or both.
Okay.
But he likes Goat Simulator. That's how I found out about Goat Simulator was him, so I bet he's into it.
All right. Well, whatever. Welcome to Whatever with Jason Soto, the comedy podcast that we just talk about whatever. I'm your host, Jason Soto, and this week we are going to talk about why there's so many streaming services, get into some favorite conspiracy theories, and of course, get into our favorite 90s song and or music video. I'm your host, Jason Soto, and I am joined by a friend of mine I have known for a very, very long time. When I met her, she was really, really crazy, and now she's just a little crazy, but she runs an awful goddamn lot. Give it up to Heather Baxindale-Walsh. What's up, Heather?
Hi, Jason. I'm still crazy. I have to be to run as far as I do. That's just how I get rid of most of it. It's there.
Yeah, I get. Well, because when I first followed you on Facebook, like, years ago, you used to do these weird statuses about, like, feral boars and pigs and unicorns and rainbows and I don't know what, and then you just kind of went quiet for a couple of years, and then suddenly you just started running.
Yeah, I think I Forrest Gumped my whole
life.
Just one day I just started running, and I just decided to fucking run everywhere. No, one of my favorite things to do is go back on those Facebook, see your memories. Uh-huh. Like, at least once a week I'll do it. And sometimes it's absolutely horrible to go, oh my God, what the frick was wrong with me? But half the time, I have no idea what I was talking about.
Yeah.
And then I can see where I was on a tangent where I must have been watching something like Scrubs, and I'm literally just posting quotes from a show that I was watching and just seeing if there was any feelers in the universe. I mean, I used to have a lot of fun on social media. I also used to drink and go on social media a lot, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and it doesn't have a breathalyzer. It just doesn't.
No, I think if they ever introduce a breathalyzer to Facebook, we're all just in trouble.
Yeah. Y'all get silent like I did and run.
So you can find Heather. She has a website called headertime.com, or you can find her on Twitter at Heather_Kenobi. And I'm going to use the past tense here, unless you're going to correct me here. You used to be the co-host of one of my favorite podcasts, the MILFcast.
No, actually, Kai, and this is on the down low. So everybody that's listening, Kai and I literally just talked like last week and said, hey, should we start MILFcasting again? Because I think, again, you were our last guest, and we joked about going on hiatus. Because we were going to take a little break, and then it's been like, I don't know, a year or two again.
Yeah, so
we're hoping to get back together after the end of November.
Okay.
Start something again.
All right. I mean, I wasn't bullshitting you or blowing smoke up your ass. I really did love the MILFcast. It was one of my favorite podcasts. Like the chemistry between you and Kai was just fucking hilarious and great. And then, like, it was more, like, you know, it was very loose. Like, you didn't have, like, rigid topics or, you know, you just, like, or you didn't review movies. You just, like, talked about stuff. And then just, like, the comedy between you two was just hilarious. Every Halloween, you guys would have me on as your only source of horror stuff, I guess.
You are our favorite. Not our only, but our favorite.
Okay, I'll take that. Which brings me to ask Heather, what is your favorite horror movie that you watch either on or near Halloween? or movies?
Poltergeist. Poltergeist is my favorite horror film of all time.
Okay.
Every year as a family, though, on Halloween, after we trick-or-treat, we always watch Hocus Pocus, which is delightfully fun. But Poltergeist is always watched every year, no matter what, by me, usually by myself. That's the movie that got me into horror. My mom and dad tried to watch it after I'd gone to bed, and I've been an insomniac since I was a little kid. So I snuck down the hall and hid behind a big pile of laundry, and I watched almost the whole movie without them knowing. And then the next day I went, "They're here." And my mom goes, "What? What? And I started quoting the movie and messing with her. And I finally just admitted to her that I had seen the movie, and she stopped tripping balls. So,
nice. Yeah.
So after that, they started letting me watch stuff.
The first time I saw Poltergeist, I was a kid. I don't remember how old I was. Maybe 10, 9, 10, maybe. And it did, like, it freaked me the fuck out, like, the first time I watched it. And I watched it with my mom. Like, a lot of these movies that you're not supposed to probably watch with your parents, I watch with my mom, because she was pretty cool like that.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And the only one that she did not want me to see was The Exorcist. And I ended up watching that by myself because she kept saying, like, "Oh, you're not ready for it. You're too young. It's going to really scare you. It's a really freaky movie." And, you know, me, I'm like, you know, like 10, 11 years old, and I'm like, "Oh, come on. I've seen Poltergeist. I watched all the Nightmare on Elm Streets and Friday the 13th. Oh, scary can it be?" No, I fucking pissed my pants the first time I watched The Exorcist. Like, it was fucking terrifying. And I was like scarred for a little while, so much so I didn't watch it again until my 20s. That's how much that movie affected me. Yeah, I did not watch. And I watched it when they released it back in theaters, back in, like, the early 2000s, when they did that footage you've never seen.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, I went and saw that with my friend.
That probably didn't help.
And, well, I saw it with my friend and my then-girlfriend at the time. And, yeah, it was even freakier because it was, like, I didn't remember a lot of the stuff because I was a kid, and I couldn't figure out what was the stuff that was either, you know, added in or wasn't there before or whatever. I couldn't remember. But all of it was freaky. Like, literally every moment of it was freaky. And now I can watch it, you know, pretty okay. I still get freaked out. It still freaks me out. But that's not my choice, actually. I just wanted to talk about that because Poltergeist made me think of that. My choice, I try to watch movies that actually take place on Halloween or maybe about Halloween. And yeah. I have two that I go with, my go-to, like the two that I have to watch. One is Trick or Treat.
Oh, that's so good!
That's a fucking fantastic movie. I love that
movie. It took me forever. I literally just watched it like a week ago for the first time. I've had it on my list forever, and man, I don't know why I haven't watched it. And yeah, oh my god, that was great.
Yeah, it's such a shame that didn't get, like, a wider release and a wider audience. Because it was in, like, well, first it was in development hell, and then it was just sitting on a shelf for a couple of years, and then they just quietly released it on, like, DVD in, like, 2009 or some shit. And then, and then it's just got a cult following, and now only certain people know about it. And I'm, like, a huge anthology film, like, freak. I love anthology movies, especially horror anthology movies. And so when I heard about this, I was like, "Oh, yeah, I gotta get my hands on that." And I'm glad I fucking finally watched it, like, a few years ago. And, yeah, I fell in love, like, immediately with it. And I watch it every Halloween now. It's, like, one of those things you have to watch on Halloween.
It's perfect. And it has all of the elements of all great horror movies. And it's not cliche. It's still scary, but not like I'm going to have nightmare scary. Like, I'm enjoying all of it. It was just, and I had such high expectations, too. I was so scared that I was going to end up hating it, and everyone's going to go, "Shut up, Heather." But I loved it. It was great.
Yeah, it's a fantastic movie. The second one I watched, now this one really is not that known. You have to kind of dig for it a little bit. But it's called the WNUF Halloween Special. And the premise of this is it's kind of like a found footage movie, but it's played out like a newscast on a local TV station somewhere in, like, America, like some small town.
That's
and
cool.
The whole movie is done like it's the beginning of the movie is the ending of this news segment that we watch, and they do like local news, and they do even weather, and then they do like commercials. Like they make commercials for this movie for like fake products that don't exist to make this newscast look real. And this is all leading up to like the WNUF Halloween special, which is done by a reporter. And his whole thing is he goes to this like supposed like haunted house in this town, and he's taken like a priest and like two like paranormal explorer people, kind of like the Warrens from The Conjuring. That's totally what they're supposed to be. And he's gonna take them into this house to try to find the ghosts and do like a séance and all this stuff in this house. And so it's leading up to all this, and then it's kind of a build. It's very slow burny, but it's kind of humorous because it takes place in the 80s. It was filmed like 2011 or something, but everything is like the 80s, like the fashion and the commercials and like the look of the video, like has those like tracking lines every now and then, and everything about it is just like so like authentic looking. And then there's like a kind of a twist at the end. I don't want to reveal it. It's really cool, and the way everything is just played out, like, and it was done so wonderfully, and it was done on like a micro budget. Like they literally had like no money when they made this movie, and they somehow cobbled like a new set. They got like this haunted house. They got like all this authentic like 80s gear, like camera equipment and microphones and clothes and stuff. And it's super wonderful. And if you can go find it, it's the WNUF Halloween special. You could probably buy a copy on Amazon. It's not streaming anywhere, unfortunately. You probably have to just buy it. But take my word for it. Like, so just buy it, and I think you'll love it, especially if you love stuff like that. Yeah, a lot of people don't talk about it. I don't know why. I wish I could just kind of tour around the country with this movie.
I never heard of it before, and I love found footage movies anyway.
Yeah.
Even when they're bad, I still kind of enjoy them. The whole concept of them
Same.
is fantastic to
Yeah, I
me.
agree.
Yeah.
I've a few years ago when I had a steady blog, I did a found footage blogathon, and I watched a lot of shitty found footage movies. I found a lot of good ones doing that, but I found a lot of shitty ones that, yeah, like you wouldn't believe. So, yeah. So this the. When this episode airs, it'll be the day before Halloween, and I've been noticing, Heather, I don't know if you've noticed, that it seems like horror movies seems to have this like resurgence. Like it seems like people
Yeah.
seem to like horror movies all of a sudden. Like why do you think that is?
I don't know. It seems to I've noticed at the very least it happens when a kind of like a new franchise seems to come out, like Scream in the 90s, late 90s, and then Saw at one point. And right now, I think we're starting to see it maybe with the rebirth of It too. Because I mean, and I think that coming back and around is it's not only getting like kids my oldest son's age into it, but it's bringing all of us people that have been loving horror forever into the newer stuff too. Because I mean, I didn't want to watch it. I'm like, I love the cheesy, you know, Tim Curry version. It's fantastic. And then I watched it and I almost shit my pants three times and I was so happy. I mean, it's really hard, especially, you know, for people that do like horror movies too. You kind of know exactly what you like or you don't. And it is hard to scare you after a while too. But it seems like they're getting more creative with it and they're taking it a lot more seriously too.
I've been noticing a lot of these, like I'll call fancy horror movies that are like artsy kind of, and it's like, oh, this is terrifying and it's gonna scare
Like The
you, but in
Witch?
a very in a very artful manner. Or like that
Yeah.
one dude who does like Hereditary, like that
Yeah.
guy's movies. Like he does these fancy like horror movies, and I seen Hereditary and I actually like it.
It's fine.
Which I think surprises people because I always say I hate slow burn movies. But I like that one. And I the reason, okay, so I hate slow burn movies when nothing's happening for like an hour and then we get plot. But like Hereditary has stuff happening that's relative to the plot of what's happening.
Yeah, it's
And
interesting.
yeah, and so I'm able to tolerate that. And I've not seen the other, his follow up, the Midsummer or whatever that's called. I haven't seen that
one yet. Yeah, I kept going to watch it this month, and I couldn't bring myself to because I thought Hereditary was good, but I'm not going to go back and watch either. And everyone said it was terrifying, and it wasn't. And I felt the same way about The Witch too.
There were some parts in Hereditary that were kind of terrifying. I wouldn't say the whole movie. Yeah, the whole movie wasn't terrifying, but there were parts that was like, holy shit.
It was good, but it's not my kind of scary, I guess.
But I do find that, like, you know, horror has these like trends that, like, you know, we had like the slashers in the 80s and then kind of the 90s, but then we haven't gotten too many slashers recently in the last like 5 years. I can't think of one like slasher movie that came out in the past like 5 years.
No,
it's been more like moody, atmospheric horror mixed with like psychological horror.
Yeah.
And I don't like, okay, I think this might have, I don't know for sure, this is where it started, but I think Jordan Peele's Get Out started this whole trend. Because I can't remember a movie like Get Out before Get Out was out. That was a lot of outs. But I remember hearing Jordan Peele was going to make a horror movie, and I was like, that's actually a good idea, because for some reason comedians and horror like go together. Like, because something about
you have to be dark to be funny.
Yeah, like the two genres always go hand in hand. Like a lot of my favorite comedians say they've written horror scripts or have helped write horror scripts, or are like, they do this thing in Hollywood, it's called punch-ups, where they'll get like a script and then they'll add jokes to it, and they'll get like scripts for horror movies and they'll add jokes, you know, to it to kind of liven it up a little bit. So like, you know, any of your favorite comedian could have wrote the jokes in like Rob Zombie's Halloween. Like, you never know. I really do believe like Jordan Peele's Get Out kind of started this whole like fancy genre of horror movies that are more like not so much focused on like blood and gore and sex, and but more like, this is a creepy place. What's going on? Like, why am I creeped out? And is like my anxiety levels like up to like a 20 right now? And like, you
I
know?
Think, yeah, I think part of that is too because it does play on the sense of realism, as though perhaps it's something that could happen to you.
Yeah, exactly.
And I like that. But
yeah,
a lot
of these movies are kind of like stuff you really could find yourself into, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you totally could find yourself at like a creepy white person's house and they're like acting weird, or you know, you
I run out of anybody's house that has a live laugh love on their wall. That's a sign that I need to get the fuck out.
Yeah,
that is the scariest thing I can ever see. Over it. Goodbye.
Yeah. So I'm just kind of interested like where horror is going to go from here. Like, I'm wondering what's the next trend that it could be. Like, you know, if we're shying away from, you know, slashers and we're in this like psychological, like what could be next? Like, what could we?
Well, you're right too, because we had the torture porn for a little while too, like the Hostel movies Saw and that kind of stuff too. So yeah, what would be next then?
Yeah, I mean, I'm excited to find out.
Everything changes now.
And snap.
What's next? The future. That's our specialty.
Heather, how many streaming services do you have, like Netflix?
I have 3 right now, and I want to have more, but I don't want to have more. And it's infuriating. It's like, infuriating.
There's, like, way too fucking many, right? Like,
yes.
There's so
yes,
many and, out, like, right now.
And I got rid of cable 4 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So,
okay.
Yeah, I don't miss it. I have my Xbox, and if I want to stream a show that's not available on any of my streaming services that I love or something, then I just pay for it, and I prefer to do it that way. But now everything's so divided that the streaming services don't offer enough of one thing. The best one I have right now is Hulu, and even that's and so, that's and for TV anyway.
I pay for 3. And I'm using my aunt's Hulu account, so I
I'm using my friend's Hulu.
I mean, I have access to 4, and yeah. I think that's a lot.
It is. It's overwhelming. That's how I felt when I just got the Hulu like a couple months ago, and I'm like, oh my god, look at all this anime. Oh my gosh, look at all this cooking shows.
Yeah.
Oh
my
gosh.
That's how you feel with yeah, like the first time you sign up.
Yeah, and then I go, I haven't logged into Netflix for a week. It probably misses me. What's going on there? Yeah, it was just so much.
That was probably everyone's first one was Netflix, because Netflix was first a DVD site. It's just you get DVDs in the mail. It's very simple. Then they got like a bug up their ass. They're like, hey, you know what would be cool? If you can watch this shit on our website. Just go to our website and pay an additional fee. And instead of having to wait for the disc to come, you can just watch it right now. And we were like, yeah, okay, that totally makes sense. We can watch like all 12 seasons of like Dexter right now if we wanted to. And then Netflix got crazy. Like Netflix took like a bunch of coke and meth and we're like we're only going to do our shows. We're going to come up with original shows and that's the only thing we're going to promote. Yeah, we'll have Dexter and Friends and The Office, but Orange is the New Black. You got to watch Orange is the New Black. We pay like $1 million for this book and now we're going to make like 9 seasons of this show and you got to watch it now. And like when you go to Netflix like right now, that's all they bombard you with is these original Netflix stuff.
Yeah.
Like, it's hard to navigate their website.
It's so difficult.
Something not Netflix.
That's actually what pisses me off the most about Netflix right now is if you do want to find anything else, you can't. And even in the sections you have to look at, it just repeats itself over and over again. It's like I watch more than 5 things. No. No, or because I watched one thing, their suggestions, they're utterly bizarre.
Yeah.
It's broken. I prefer, at least, and Amazon is the other one that I have.
Yes, I was going to get right into that.
Yeah, and Amazon, I actually prefer Amazon to that as far as it goes.
Because then Amazon got into it, and they're like, well, we're going to start streaming shit off from our website, and we're going to make original shows.
And like, we're going to give you free shipping. Way to go. Like,
wait.
For anybody that's compulsive.
Wait, the company that I order potato chips, shoes, and like season 2 of Supernatural is going to start making TV shows? Like, what the hell? What the hell's going on? And then it just went nuts after that. Like, suddenly, everywhere you look, everybody's getting a streaming service. Like, fucking Disney's getting their own, like, coming up in November. They're going to have their own streaming service where you can only stream only Disney and Disney-owned stuff, which at this point is like fucking everything, so why not, right? And then there's fucking HBO Go and or HBO Max, and I don't know what the differences are.
I don't either.
Because I thought HBO Go, I thought was their streaming site, but apparently they're going to also come out with one called Max. And they bought, I think they're the ones that bought Friends from Netflix. So they're going to stream Friends on HBO, which is really fucking weird.
Yeah. Well, they're also putting Sesame Street on HBO now, too.
Yeah, that was weird.
Well, it's actually good for Sesame Street, I think, because they're going to be paying for it. It's just going to be on there before, and then all the shows will come back on PBS. So it's not like people are going to lose access to it, but it's still weird.
And then there's even ones that kind of pop up that are new that are streaming services, like Shudder. I have Shudder, which is the all horror Netflix, basically.
Yeah, I saw that.
And I have that. I have that. And
what is Crackle? Funny. Is Crackle one
Crackle,
too?
It's kind of like that. It's kind of like a mix between that and YouTube, which YouTube YouTube tried to do this too, and they failed miserably. Like,
was that the YouTube red?
Yes. Yes. Nobody went with red whatsoever.
They got Cobra Kai on there, and that was it.
Yeah, and now YouTube Red is gone, and now everything's just on regular YouTube, which is fucking hilarious. No, but Crackle's kind of like a mix of Netflix and YouTube, kind of. But no, going back to Shudder, I accidentally purchased a Shudder subscription. Because I wanted to watch... okay, we all know who Eli Roth is, right? He's the director of Hostel. Okay, so he had this TV show on AMC called like Horror History or something. I can't remember what it was called. But it was like... every week was like a different horror genre. Like one was slashers, one was psychological, one was zombies, and so on and so forth. And I really wanted to watch the show, but I missed the original airing on AMC. So I heard that Shudder was gonna be hosting this. So they have a free trial thing where you sign up for like 14 days. And I went for it and I watched it and I was like, oh, this is cool, and it is a cool show. I highly recommend it. But I forgot to turn it off. And so they charged my card, and for some reason they picked the 1 year subscription. And so I was like wrestling with it. I'm like, do I just call them and say I don't want it, or do I keep it? Because I already paid for it, and I'm looking at their site, and they got a bunch of cool shit on there. And I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm gonna keep it. I got it for a year. If I don't like it, I just won't do it next year. And I am actually glad I accidentally got it, because it's been fucking fantastic. Like, Shudder is seriously a very underrated streaming site. Like, people don't talk about it nearly as much. There's two highlights on Shudder. One of them is, I don't know if you remember, Heather, there was a guy on TNT in the 90s called Joe Bob Briggs.
Yes.
Okay, he's on Shudder now. He does that show on Shudder, where he introduces horror movies like every week. He's not on now. He's not on right now, but he's coming back sometime later this year. And he's on there now, and he's doing his thing there, which is awesome. And then there's a Creepshow TV show on Shudder.
Oh, I loved Creepshow.
Yeah, and this show is fantastic. It is seriously awesome. It's very much like the movies. It's each episode's like two stories. It's done exactly like Creepshow. It has like the comic book panels in between the scenes with transitions. It's campy as all fuck. They got like a lot of like celebrities on this. Like, they got like the dude from Saw, like Tobin Bell. Adrian Barbeau's in it. What's his name? Like, a lot of people. Like, David Arquette was in the last episode. A lot of celebrities are in this, so I highly recommend it. But going back to my point, I think we're getting way too many streaming services. To the point that IMDb now has a streaming service. Like, they just launched this thing called IMDb TV. Which is very hard to say. And they're going to have like original content on there and like stuff on there just to stream. And I'm like, come on, man. You're just a website to like list movies. You don't have to fucking start streaming. Like,
no, it's basically you're going to end up turning it into just a bunch of different cable channels anyway, where you're offering your own individual stuff instead of outsourcing, and it's going to be the same thing, except you're paying for it individually, which is obnoxious.
And that's the thing, because like cable, it's like you just pay like, I don't know, $50. I'm just picking a number, $50, and you get all these channels. Whereas now you got to pay $12.99 a month for this one site, and $8.99 for this site a month, and then this one $7.99 a month. And I don't even know which one is more expensive.
No, that's exactly it. They'll all start adding up, and then after the point, you're not really saving money, which is, I think, why a lot of people started doing it in the first place. You still have access to all of these shows and movies, and then some original content. But I mean, I get that everyone wants to get in on the game, but it's kind of killing it too.
I know, because there's such a thing as oversaturation. Like, if you have too much of something, you're gonna get blowback. And pretty soon, like, fucking Twitter is going to have, like, a Twitter streaming channel 24/7 of, like, I don't know, Doctor Who, and then no one's going to buy it. Like, you know, it's just going to be too much, and it's really annoying.
You know what will happen is people start buying box sets again. Like, I don't need these streaming services. I'll just own it. Well, that's actually what I do a lot. I like owning physical copies of things because I'm old and it makes me happy to touch them and hold them. But I do digital downloads too, where if it's a show that I love and I want to have anyway and always have access to, I'll eventually just buy it.
I wonder if physical DVD companies are like oversaturating streaming services, so people could just like give up and be like, oh, we're gonna go back to DVDs, and then DVD company like, muhaha, it worked.
Yeah, evil maniacal laughter. We played the long game.
Yeah. So, well, you know what that sounds like? That sounds like a conspiracy theory.
Oh, by the way, I've cracked the code. I figured out the shadow organizations and the Illuminati know that they're finally primed for world domination.
Oh, I learned how to do transitions in my new podcasting world. Yay, I'm awesome. Give me a high five. Give me a high five, Heather.
Oh,
yeah.
You like that? Oh, yeah. Good.
Exactly. I felt that, too. All right, so this is the day before Halloween, and so I wanted to do something kind of creepy and spooky. And so last week, I had the Vern on, and we did sort of urban legends. This week, we're going to talk about conspiracy theories. The creepier, the better. And I asked Heather if she had a favorite conspiracy theory, whether she believed it or not. And she says she has one, and I have a couple. One's a very quick one, and then one's kind of detailed. But Heather, I'll let you go first. What's your conspiracy theory?
My favorite one is not one that I believe in at all.
Good. Okay.
And it isn't. And I love conspiracy theories. I think they're good. I think it's good to question things sometimes. The problem is with most of them, people are trying to prove that they're right instead of doing what you're supposed to do with any theory, which is try to disprove it. And then if it still exists, then that means that it's plausible.
Uh-huh.
So the newest one that even makes the whole "we never landed on the moon" one seem just tee hee hee is these fucking flat earthers.
Oh yes.
Oh my god. I'm obsessed. I mean, it's seriously, like, I went through a month where I could do nothing but just obsess over these people. I was reading everything I could. It started off as just a, oh no, that's just a meme. It's pretty funny. It's another meme. Why are there so many of these memes? Are there really this many people? And then the next thing I know, I see a Netflix documentary, which I had to watch.
Oh god.
It's literally insane.
Yeah.
And it's not even so much the questioning of our reality and if we made this up in our heads, etc., blah blah blah. It is the fact that they are creating their own ideas, like things that make no sense. Like, we just get to a wall and it's a big giant wall of ice, like in Game of Thrones. Mm-hmm. And all of the governments in the world have banded together and they're running this little show with us and we have no idea what's going on. And they've made an ice wall that they all live behind and they're just watching us. I mean, that's one of the theories of what is actually going on. Another mm-hmm. one, Australia isn't real.
I heard about that because I have a friend who lives in Australia. She sent me a link saying, well, yeah, I guess I don't exist.
I mean, that's where they used to send people to no longer exist because everything there wants to kill you. But yeah, my running dad, he's lived there for the last 3 years, 4 years now. Mm. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's real. I mean, look what they created. Many, many, many. Isn't Chris Hemsworth from Australia?
Yes, he is, actually.
Yes, he's Thor. He's a god. Come on, get it together. No, it's just, even in the documentary with this huge group, they set together real scientific tests.
Uh-huh.
And they were going to, you know, do them. One was with a gyrosphere and another one had something to do with the curvature of the Earth over a distance where the light spectrum would meet something. Both of their scientific tests failed. And they were just kind of like, bummer, that costs a lot of money. We have to figure out how to make this work so our theory works.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they stood in the face of their own experiments that they came up with on their own that failed them. And they were so committed to their belief that they just said, oh, well, here's fact right in front of me. Nah, that's crazy. It was my own plan, yet wrong. Let's find something else. I mean, the absolute nonsensicalness of it all is bizarre. And yes, you got some of the people that you would expect, like the guys who've lived in their mom's basement for 40 years and, mm-hmm. you know, they never leave. But some of these people seem like relatively normal people until they start talking.
Hmm.
And it's crazy. Like, where are we in this planet to where there are thousands and thousands of people that think that the planet is still flat?
Okay, so about that, my favorite thing about those people is how they try to prove that it's flat and that they're always trying to go up into space, but like they're building their own rockets.
Yeah.
And then they just like fail spectacularly.
All of them do. Everything they do fails, and they will not accept the failure.
No.
It's not even, let's move on and try something else. It's, well, I'm just going to make up an excuse for that. It's like a two-year-old where there's just literally no logic there. It's bonkers. Mm-hmm. Absolutely yeah. bonkers. But it's fascinating at the same time. I can't turn away from it. I mean, it is, like, some people like the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills or whatever. I like the flat earthers. Give them to me. I'm going to watch them.
All right. Well, mine's a little, okay, my first one's a little, is very well known. It's nothing new, so I'll be very quick about it. But, so my thing about conspiracy theories is that I don't believe any of them. Like, all the famous ones, I don't believe them. But I find them amusing, and I find them fascinating, in, like, the length of, like, how far they'll go into the story to prove their point.
Yeah.
And my favorite one of that is the whole Paul McCartney is dead thing.
Tupac too.
I watched. Yeah, no.
Tupac's alive. That's it.
Tupac's. Yeah, he's just alive. No, yeah. But the theory says that. Okay, so well, first of all, there was this movie that I watched. It was a documentary, quote unquote, on Netflix, which is now, strangely enough, can't be found anymore. So ooh. But it was literally called "Paul is Dead: The Taped Confessions of George Harrison." And the framework of this was George Harrison on his deathbed taped a confession that he, Ringo, and John Lennon did in fact cover up the death of Paul McCartney, the real Paul McCartney, and here's how they did it. And so the story was one night while recording, I think Rubber Soul, I think that was the album, Paul McCartney got into like a big fight with like the other Beatles and stormed out. And it was, like, raining, and so he got into a car and drove. And then he got into a very bad car accident, which killed him. And so the police called John Lennon and say, you know, hey, we found Paul McCartney's body, and we need you to, you know, ID it to make sure it's him. And they go and they ID him, and then they're like, well, fuck, we're, like, at the height of our popularity. We can't just give up. And so years earlier, they had a Paul McCartney lookalike contest where they found a guy who won. And I don't remember what the guy's name was. I could probably look it up. But they found the guy who won who did look exactly like Paul McCartney. And they hired him to be Paul McCartney for, like, basically for all of time. And so they made him Paul McCartney. And then they finished recording Rubber Soul. But the band felt guilty about this. And so they put hints in, like, every song and album they've done ever since. And some of the hints on various albums include, like, one album, Paul McCartney's facing, got his back turned to the camera while everyone else is facing forward to represent Paul's not really there. And the whole thing about on the cover of Abbey Road, Paul's the only one who's barefoot because he's to represent him walking in heaven or some weird shit like
maybe
that.
Maybe he was just stoned. Jesus, shit.
So, and like, it was this very intricate, like, you know, stuff that was within, like, the Beatles' discography and album covers. And the best one is if you look up the Sgt. Pepper Lonely Hearts Club Band album and look up the conspiracy theory on that cover alone, it'll fucking blow your mind. Because there's like 20 hints about Paul being dead on that cover, like, alone. Like,
I'm sure that's exactly what they would do. They were like, we're going to spend the rest of our history pretending that this imposter over here is Paul. And we're going to give everyone hints about it. And
go ahead.
God, it's just so bad. Well, that's exactly it, too. That's when you start looking for stuff. It's finding Jesus in your grilled cheese. You know, it's what you want to see, so that's what you're seeing. Well, you can find as many coincidences as you want in something if you start looking for them.
I was eating a Dorito the other day, and I saw Mary Magdalene on there, and I was like, oh, wow, cool. And it tasted pretty good, I would say. It was probably the best tasting chip out of all that whole bag.
There's actually a condition or something for this. It's called something like the flag shooter thing, and it's based on JFK looking for all the coincidences to make the connections that you want.
Yeah.
And you do it, and you skip over all the things that don't make sense because you want to prove what you believe.
Exactly.
Yeah, like Paul McCartney is
one more thing about the Paul McCartney thing. Now I'll move on to my.
That's
second
fascinating.
One.
I've never heard it before. That's absolutely really? Fascinating. Yeah,
oh,
and I love the Beatles.
Oh,
no.
That's like the most like famous one. I thought you for sure heard of it.
No. Oh, that's
okay.
Okay.
I didn't want to go too deep into it because it's like the most popular theory. Because like they have an album called the White Album.
Yeah.
And one of the songs is called Revolution Number 9. And if you play it backwards, it says Paul is dead. Like that whole thing. You seriously never heard that before?
This my whole life, wow. And I'm a Beatles fan. This is a beautiful, beautiful revelation.
Oh, you have to look this up. It is fantastic.
I guess this is gonna be my next new obsession.
But my favorite part of this whole this documentary was, and you have to know a little bit about Paul McCartney's like relationships with people, like you know his ex-wives and stuff. He said that the quote unquote George Harrison in this movie. Says that in like 2005 or something, he married Paul McCartney, quote unquote, married this girl named Heather Mills, who only had one leg. Well, turns out that when Heather Mills was a little girl, she got into a car accident in England that took the life of one Paul McCartney. How she lost her leg.
Yeah,
that was like my favorite thing of the whole documentary was that little tidbit. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me?
It's insanity. This isn't okay. Like the Wizard of Floyd where you're playing, you know, Pink Floyd with the Wizard of Oz where you're going, that's just fucking cool. No, this is fucked up.
Yeah, it's there's a whole lot. Like you have to just look it up. Just there's so much I skipped over. Because I just thought it was really well known. I don't have all that in front of me.
That's fine. I have the next month of my life planned now. Thank you.
So, okay, here's the main one I want to talk about. And this one is probably legitimately a little creepy. Because a lot of stuff is unknown. A lot of stuff isn't answered. And there's a lot of mysteries. Do you know anything about the Denver International Airport?
Yes, it's huge. And I've been there a couple times.
Oh, shit. Okay, well, did you know... there's a lot of weird fucking shit going on in that place.
No, but I want to know now. Tell me.
So it was opened on February 28th, 1995. They fell behind schedule and it was $2 million over budget. The final cost was $4.8 billion, which is a lot of money for an airport. And people don't know where all the money went to because the airport is not super huge, but it's not tiny either, according to this. It's 35,000 acres.
It's big. I had to run across it once. It's big. And I run. Remember, I'm four.
Yes, that's true.
It's big.
So one of the things is that the runways look like a swastika. If you look at it from above. And looking at this picture, it totally does look like a swastika, so that's weird. The shape of it is not a typical formation for airports' runways. Usually they're just kind of straight lines. But these are one is basically like a swastika. Like one's going to the left, one's going up, one's going down, one's going to the left, and it's really weird looking. And the airport is like in the center of it.
Mm-hmm.
The airport dedication stone has imagery from a secret society. it was dedicated on March 9th, 1994, and on it there's a Masonic symbol of a compass with the capital G inside it, which is, you know, the Mason's symbol. But underneath the date, it's credited by the New World Airport Commission. And when people are asked, what is the New World Airport Commission? They just say that it's a commission for the New World Airport. But if you know anything about conspiracy theories, there's this whole thing about the New World Order, which is like its whole Wikipedia page onto itself.
Yeah.
So the fact that they chose the words New World Airport Commission has a lot of people like freaked out. And then, you know, the Masons are tied into like, you know, the New World Order stuff as well, along with the Illuminati. And they're you know, so that two stuff just kind of, you know, is linked up there. There are a lot of oddly suspicious underground tunnels and bunkers under the airport, and no one knows why they're there or what they're there for. So as far as anyone can tell, nobody uses them or nobody goes down in there that anyone has seen. A former airport construction worker said that the reason why they were so far behind was because of the 5 multi-story buildings that were built underneath the airport. But nobody could tell him what this was for. This led to a bunch of theories, as these are the New World Order command bunkers, or it's going to be a fallout shelter for, like, the eventual nuclear war that's going to happen, to maybe it's a FEMA concentration camp. Nobody knows. There are a lot of strange murals across the airport. One of them that I'm looking at here. Let me see if I can. I'm not an art critic, so I don't know if I can totally describe this. So it's in the forest, and the forest is on fire. And on the right, there's an image of a buffalo hovering over a little blonde-haired white boy holding a dove. Next to an Indian guy, next to two different types of Indians, the Native American Indian and then the Indian from India Indian. Next to, I think, a black chick, next to an Asian boy, next to a redhead girl who has a penguin in a glass display case. And on, they're facing this table that has, like, an Indian Virgin Mary picture on it, and then they're surrounded by, like, turtles and dolphins and parrots, and there's a dead girl who looks like Heidi in a coffin.
What?
and there's a black girl across from her, also in a coffin. I'm guessing these are coffins. They're dead because they got their arms crossed and they look like they're dead. And, you know, like, remember the opening of the Flintstones when they go into the drive-in and they put the stack of ribs on Fred's car? There's, like, those ribs are in the background or the foreground of this picture as well. So that's just one of the many, many interesting pictures that you can find. And no one knows what the fuck that means or what it's for. And, yeah, it's weird. There's a few other ones I won't super get into, but they're all very weird, very similar looking with a bunch of, like, the theme seems to be
multicultural. Oh my goodness, I'm looking at the one you just described right now. This is bizarre.
There's one with all these, like, multicultural kids, like, touching this flower, and there's, like, a leopard in the back and a hummingbird and a swan.
It just looks like apocalyptic stuff.
Yeah. Me.
But I'm not an art person either, so this just looks like too much LSD to me.
There's this other one with, like a soldier in a gas mask lying with some doves on top of it, and a bunch of kids surrounded by a banner that says peace in different languages.
Here's one with a sword, and then there's dead babies and ladies crying. What the frig?
And then there's one with a scary Nazi soldier and a quote from a child who died in Auschwitz.
Why would you put this in an airport?
And then probably the most interesting one is the outside of the airport. There's a giant blue horse statue. It's titled Mustang, but everyone nicknamed it Blucifer. The statue is 32 feet tall and 9,000 pounds. Its eyes glows red at all hours of the day and night, causing some to speculate the statue is meant to represent the fourth horseman of the apocalypse from the biblical book of Revelations. The fourth horseman basically represents death.
Yeah, this is horrible looking.
And then the creepy part. the statue's artist, Luis Jimenez, was actually killed by the statue in 2006. Before the statue was completed, a piece of the statue fell on him and severed an artery in his leg.
I shouldn't be laughing, but I'm so sorry. I can't stop.
Yeah. So, wow. I don't know what the fuck is going on. And this was before Colorado legalized weed. So, I can only imagine what the fuck it's like there now.
Oh, my God. Okay, I'd like to just chalk it up to somebody who has really bad fucking taste. But that is pretty bizarre across the board. Wow.
And then
the art itself is fucked.
And then I'm just looking at the, I'm glancing at the Wikipedia page, and it talks about it like it's all normal. Like, it was opened in 1995. The Denver National Airport currently has nonstop service 215 destinations among 23 different airlines throughout North America, Latin America, Europe, and Asia. It is the fourth airport in the U.S. to exceed 200 destinations. So there you go, a little tidbit for you. It's the fifth busiest airport in the United States. Let's see. They don't have the world for some reason.
I never saw any of these murals that I recall. And the first time I went there, I wasn't rushing through it. And I stopped and I had a beer because I'm terrified of flying. Okay. So I had actually a couple beers. And I remember where I was having the beer and lunch. And it was a nice airport. It wasn't anything other than large. I didn't recall anything specific about it that stood out. I don't remember that fucking horse. What the hell? That's weird.
Here we go. Here's some accidents and incidents. On September 5th, 2001, a British Airways Boeing 777 caught on fire while it was being refueled at the gate. None of the deplaning passengers or crew were injured, but the refueler servicing the aircraft died from his injury 6 days after the fire. They found that the accident occurred due to a failure of the aircraft's refueling ring when the fuel hose was torn out at an improper angle. On February 16th, 2007, 14 aircraft suffered windshield failures within a 3.5-hour period at the airport. A total of 26 windshields on these aircrafts failed. That's fucked right there.
Yep.
December 20th.
Just keep reinforcing why I don't like to fly, too. It's
December
fine.
December 20th, 2008, a Boeing 737 operating as Flight 1404 to Houston veered off the left of the side of runway 34 and caught on fire during its takeoff at Denver International Airport. There was no snow or ice on the runway. However, there was 31 knot winds at the time. And they said the probable cause of the accident was the captain's cessation of right rudder input, whatever that means, must be an aviation thing. 38 people got injured, but no one got killed, so that's good. Is this one creepy? Read the head on this one. No, that one's not very creepy. But still, that's four weird incidents that happened at this airport.
It is weird.
So, yeah, so that one, it has to be my favorite.
Hey,
conspiracy.
Even this one shot of it down the side, it looks like the air, the top parts, it looks like the atmosphere buildings from Aliens.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're doomed. Okay, so that's another airport that I probably shouldn't go to again. I'm just not flying anymore. I just can't do it. I almost died the last time I flew. This is not for me. It has nothing to do with the murals. Okay, maybe a little bit. But, oh, I see the swastika thing, too. That's funny. Yeah. I mean, it's not funny. It's funny.
it's kind of funny. All right, so we just had a lot of fun talking about conspiracy theories. But I actually know this guy who's super into conspiracy theories. So much so, he didn't give me an exact real name. He goes by the name Mr. Secret. And he wanted to do a bit on my show where he wanted to warn people about various things, you know, out in the world. And so, with some hesitation, I present to you, Watch Out with Mr. Secret. Watch out for Amazon Fire Sticks. The government uses these to track you. They know what you watch and what you buy in order to keep tabs on you. How do I know this? I just do. Don't question me. You think they would just give these things out for free if they weren't used for tracking, huh? They're not free? They're $35? That's even more proof they're the government. Only the government would charge $35. Why $35? Why not $19.99? Why not $29.99? $35. And you know who the 35th president of the United States was? JFK. And you know who killed JFK? The government. They're telling you right there. They killed JFK. And they're telling you by making these tracking devices and have them cost $35. And you know what a fire stick is code word for? Cigarette. And how do they kill poor people? Poison cigarettes. Amazon Fire Sticks are also trying to poison you. You plug these into your so-called televisions. And they not only track you, but they poison you while you use it. And these things they call jailbreaking, you think that will prevent them from tracking you? Bah! That's how they track you even more! They track you harder! Why do you think they haven't done anything to stop people from jailbreaking them? They know you're doing it, and they don't care! They say, fine! Jailbreak it again, so we can triple track you! Ooh, triple tracking is the worst. You don't want to be triple tracked. In conclusion, watch out for Amazon Fire Sticks! All right, thank you very much, Mr. Secret. We will be on the lookout for that. Whew, I don't know where I get these people.
I don't want to be triple tracked. I just know that. That's what I've learned. It's important.
Maybe.
Hello, everybody. My name is DeVern, and I'm the host of the Cinema Recall Podcast, part of That Moment In. We are slightly different than your average movie podcast in that we don't review a whole feature. Instead, myself and a guest will break down our favorite scenes in movies and then discuss why they are so iconic. So check us out. We are available on Anchor, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, and more. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Instagram under Cinema Recall Podcast, and we are available on Twitter at @Cinema_Recall. We hope you enjoy. Thank you for listening.
All right, so let's put all that behind us, and let's go ahead and talk about one of my favorite things, which is 90s music. One of my favorite eras of music was the 90s, just in general. All 90s was just fucking awesome. And so every week I'm gonna have a different favorite 90s song or music video, and I'm gonna have my guest come up with theirs as well. Let me go first really quick. Mine, because we're getting into the Halloween season, where it's gonna be Halloween, you know, tomorrow, and I had to go for some kind of creepy, and I went with Marilyn Manson's cover of Sweet Dreams Are Made of These. Like, that song is, like, legitimately, like, his. Like, he took this 80s basic, like, synth song, and he just made it Marilyn Manson with his, like, creepy voice, and then the music, and, like, everything about it is just so, like, wonderful, to the point where it gets used, like, in almost every kind of, like, sort of mainstream horror movies, at least like in the early 2000s. Like,
yeah,
every horror movie used a song in the trailer. It's one of my favorite Marilyn Manson songs. I don't like a lot of his songs, honestly, just to be completely honest.
I do. I'm a big fan. However, that particular song was one of my favorites when I was a kid, and the video, I didn't know the name of the song, so I'd always tell my mom, I want to watch the Moo Moo video, because there was cows in it. So I called it the Moo Moo song for, like, ever. So
nice.
So when he did it, I had, like, this real attachment to it, and then he still just killed it. It's good. It is.
So, all right, so that was my pick, just Marilyn Manson's Sweet Dreams. What's yours, Heather? What do you got for me?
This was really hard for me. 90s is probably my favorite decade of music as well. And
nice.
I am a huge music person. I listen to all genres of music other than country. Okay, everything. Everything's on the table. I tried to look at it from what my favorite video was, because I can't tell you how much time I spent in my room watching nothing but MTV, because I think the world would be a better place if MTV kept playing videos.
Oh, totally. 100%.
But yeah, but they stopped. So the world is going into flat earthers. So So I quickly came up with my least favorite, which is absolutely Love Fool from the Cardigans. If you want to go insane, just play it on repeat over and over and you will lose your mind. But I was thinking videos. My first thought was Sabotage and Beastie Boys. It's so fantastic. Then I went to Virtual Insanity, which is a Jamiroquai, and I love the song and I love the video. It's just bananas.
Yeah.
But my favorite song from the 90s, it's not metal, not rap. It's a pop song. It's Your Woman, White Town.
Yes.
This song is so fucking sick. It is so good. And it like should never have been a big hit.
Okay. So that music video is fucking weird, right?
Yeah. Okay, so the whole concept of the song is weird, too. It's like being in love with someone you shouldn't be in love with, but it's really about this whole Marxist, like, silent movie. It's black and white, and, it's weird. It's totally weird.
Yeah, it's one of those, like, I remember watching that video, like, every single day on MTV. Like, it just played nonstop. And I was just, like, befuddled by the music video. I was like, what is happening in this?
But that's the perfect essence of the 90s, too. It doesn't, like, they just throw shit in the videos that didn't make sense. And there was always, like, flashbacks to black and white in 90s videos, too. And you would have a guy who was just standing there and looked like he might be homeless or not, hanging out, and a bird would fly out of nowhere. I mean, there were so many of these weird things people used to do with videos. But this whole entire video was a video like that. It's weird, but I love it.
Okay. All right. Awesome. So those are our 90s songs and music videos for the week. Marilyn Manson's Sweet Dreams and White Town's Your Woman. All right, so this podcast is about a week old, and I've been listening to podcasts for about 10, 11 years now, and I've noticed that the key, I think, to having a very popular podcast is the sponsorship. And I think that's what I've been missing all these years of podcasting, is I haven't been able to get a sponsor. Because, like, all of my favorite podcasts, they're sponsored by, like, Squarespace or like snack boxes and stuff like that. And I think what I need to do is I think I need to let these companies know that they can trust me to sell their products in a way that will be appealing to the masses. So what I think I can do is if I show people, you know, the companies out there, that I can make an ad for about anything, I can get some sponsorships from, like, actual people, like, companies, and maybe I can get some money rolling into this podcast. But what I found out through my lawyers is that it's very highly illegal to do an ad for a real product. Like, I can't do a product for Squarespace because they're not paying me. So that would be illegal because they would probably throw me in jail or something. I don't want that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do an ad for a product that doesn't exist to show, you know, that I can do this. So here's an ad for a product now. Hey, Heather, I heard about the promotion. High five.
I can't.
What? Why not? I'm just asking for a simple high five.
I can't because I'm carrying my wallet, my keys, my lipstick, my knife, my pills, my...
Why don't you just put them in your pants pocket?
Because I don't have pants pockets.
Gasp! How dare you! Has this ever happened to you, ladies? You become socially awkward because you don't have pockets in your pants to hold your most basic and valuable items?
How can I carry all this stuff?
Well, now you can with Women's Pants Pockets. The pants with pockets. The pockets are big and deep, so you can carry any and all of the following items. Keys, lipstick, wallet, gun, birth control pills, your child's crappy drawing, bottled water, a bottle of vodka, a bottle of tequila, and more. Hi, I'm famous podcaster Jason Soto, and if you go to www.womenpantspockets.com and use the promo code WHATEVER, you'll get 20% off your first order of Women's Pants Pockets. And if you order now, you'll get a second pair of pants for half off. That's right, you'll get 20% off your whole order and a second pair for half off. But if you come to my place, they'll be 100%.
Nope.
Okay. Well, 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 if it isn't too cool to give me a high five. And, hey, I like those pants.
Thanks. Now can I have that high five?
Sure. Ow! That was my face.
Thanks, Women's Pants Pockets, for freeing up my hand to smack this guy in the face.
You're welcome, Women's Pants Pockets. It's about freaking time. All right, so that was another episode of Whatever with Jason Soto. Next week, I'm going to have my special co-host, Lackey, and we are going to attempt to help some people with their problems and what movie would make a fun board game and what board game would make a fun movie. Whatever with Jason Soto was hosted by me, Jason Soto, and I can be found on Twitter at CineGamerJason. My name's going to change soon on Twitter. I'm waiting for the Halloween season to end because right now my name on Twitter is a Halloween name that slowly just says, this is my Halloween name. So I'm gonna wait till November 1st to change it from CineGamer to I'll change it to something. But if you don't want to reach me on Twitter, you can email me at whateverjasonsoto@gmail.com. And for some really weird fucking reason, last episode I forgot to mention the Facebook page, which is facebook.com/whateverwithjasonsoto. If you go there, hit the like and notification buttons, you'll know when a new episode is posted. And I also share some hot spicy memes that I've stolen from people, along with whatever garbage I think of. My special co-host this week was Heather Baxindale-Walsh. You can find her on Twitter at Heather_Kenobi or at her website, headertime.com. Heather, you are the most wonderful person to talk to, and I love talking to you on any podcast I ever have. So thank you very much for coming on this one.
Thank you so much for having me on. I missed you. This was great.
Yeah, I miss you too. And I cannot tell Kai I want to be, if not the first guest on the MILFcast, at least the second. So
I will
make that happen.
I'm usually in charge of the booking and everything. He just doesn't know it.
Okay. Awesome. I'm looking forward to it. All right. So this podcast can be found on Podomatic, Spotify, and anywhere else you get podcasts from, with the exception of your grandma's attic. Now, I know she's a borderline hoarder and has all kinds of neat stuff up there, including Jimmy Hoffa's leg, but I assure you, this podcast will not be found in there. The opening and closing music is Battle of Who Could Care Less by Ben Folds 5 off their album Whatever and Ever Amen. I do not own the song, nor do I exactly have permission, but I do have fair use on my side, as I'm not making any money off of it. If someone wants to pay me to do this podcast, I'll come up with the original song or just pay somebody to cover the song. And don't forget what I always say, keep your head in the clouds and your feet in the mud. Good night, everybody.